successful. I think we survived 10 years, which is success and nothing in this environment. And a few years ago, we decided to try to do something about medical cannabis. And the first thing we did was we reviewed, so we actually managed what's then people we know had a conversation with David Cameron. Who knows what Cameron was? He was a prime minister. Wasn't he? You've forgotten. You should, because he was a horrible, useless prime minister.
He jumped to see him from the ship.
Anyway, we discovered that he wasn't prepared to change the regulations on medical cannabis because the World Health Organization, WHO, refused. So we just, we then went back and we looked at the WHO decision making. To our horror, that they have never reviewed medical cannabis. That the decision that cannabis had no medical value, which the WHO were continuing to declare, even in 2016, was based on a report that was written in 1934 under the League of Nations. And we started working with a Dutch pharmacist who used to be one of the secretariats for psychotropic medicine in the WHO in Geneva. And he resigned because he eventually got sick to death of the fact that they were just not facing the truth, not doing what they should do. And he was called Willem Schulte, and he, me, and two other colleagues, we worked out that the only way the WHO would review any medicine is if you give them, they have to have a formal report, which is structured according to a detailed template. And they weren't contracting this report. They were contracting reports for all sorts of pointless things, you know, like methadone or ketamine, but they weren't doing it for medical cannabis. We sort of said, why not? They said, we couldn't afford it. So that seems pretty plausible, but never mind, if you can't afford it, then we'll do it for you. So we did it. We did this report. We showed, as you might predict, that cannabis is a medicine. We gave them all the evidence. And we took the report to them and said, here's your report. Now you should get your expert committee to read this report and act on it. And they refused to receive it on the grounds that they hadn't contracted it. But so we gave it to the experts, who were international experts. At least they couldn't avoid, they couldn't escape the fact that there was a report. And eventually, the year after, they were forced then to actually contract their own reports. In fact, they contracted a whole series of reports and everything. And but then last year, they decided that cannabis was a medicine. But it's not been ratified internationally, because once the WHO decides an illegal drug is a medicine, it then has to go to another organization. UNODC, United Nations Office of Drugs and Crime, which then has to decide whether making a medicine will increase the criminality associated with cannabis. And because the main players in the UNODC are Russia, China, America, and Japan, all of which hate drugs and drug users, it's not been ratified. So the status is still sitting there until then. Anyway. I'm telling you this just to share with you the bizarre attitude that people have taken internationally to cannabis over a very long time. And actually, the funny thing was, when we were in Geneva at the WHO, several members of our group were actually refused admittance to the building because they were just a little sort of irritating to the people there, because they were asking very hard questions. And they were expelled. They're with us. And they said, excuse me, it's well. Because actually, we, the United Nations and the WHO, are institutions which are beyond the law. They have their own police force. So the WHO police force took these two people, they took them out of the building, they took them across the road where into Switzerland. They were in Switzerland, but they're a separate, the WHO is a separate one place, like the Vatican. And they refused to let back in, they took their passports. So that they couldn't have to stay there until eventually they were returned with complaint. But I didn't realise that the WHO was also a kind of an instrument. instrument of oppression. I always thought it was something that was in the, had the purpose of facilitating healthcare in the world, not stopping it. But we were, did it, we were able to ask the WHO, if we could see that 1934 report, which says the cannabis is a little bit bad, just so we could see what the evidence was. And he said, no, we couldn't see it. And we said, well, why not? And he said, because it's been lost. I mean, I don't know what you think, but I think the idea that you defend a position for 84 years on evidence that you don't even, you know, can't find is beyond absurd. And anyway, it got changed. The British government then fell into line and said, cannabis is medicine, but you've only two prescriptions on the NHS. And why is that? Well, that's because of the history of cannabis. And I think the problem actually is in the medical profession. So I am a doctor. I was a doctor. I still am a doctor of sorts. I've still got a certificate of good standing in the GMC, but I don't know how long that will last. But anyway, let me just take you through some of the history, because this is the most political drug in history. There's no question. No other drug has had this peculiar vilification over decades. So it starts off, we've got evidence going back for 4,000, nearly 5,000 years. The cannabis is almost certainly, but certainly very likely, the world's oldest medicine. And this is great. I just love this. There's this. I should say these. So these slides. Actually, let me get backtracked. So one of the things drug science did was we contracted, earlier here, last summer, to produce a slide set, an educational slide set, because we realised one of the problems that doctors have is they don't know anything about medical cannabis because they don't get taught it because it's not medicine, is it? Because it's going to, et cetera. So we thought, let's rectify that. Let's get a slide set. In fact, there are two slide sets. This is one. There's a parallel one on endocannabinoids. Let's get that put together, since we work with her, she's led this. So at the very least, if you want to learn about this, you can go onto our drug science website. All these slides are there. They're not quite as good as these, because some of them have got typos, which I've just corrected for my talk today, but never mind. They're there, the content of them is the same. And you can, if anyone's, your mentors or your bosses or your teachers, wants to argue and say that cannabis doesn't have history, doesn't have value, you can go there and you can quote to them these data. And hopefully you will do that. Because my own personal belief is that cannabis is going to be the biggest medical advance in your lifetime. There are so many medical opportunities for cannabis. And particularly in areas of brain science where there's very little innovation at present. Cannabis could be really revolutionary. So learn about it because it could be very transformational. I just love this one here. The first word for what the first word talking about anesthesia, intoxication, basically comes from the Chinese word for being stoned. Now, you heard from Hannah about William O'Shaughnessy. So, cannabis was widely used in other cultures for millennia, but it didn't really come to Britain until 1842. And started being sold, like most plant medicines. Opium was being sold, cocaine was being sold, as tinctures, and people were using them. And it was very popular. Queen Victoria, we believe, used it. The royal physician at the time, Dr. Russell Reynolds, wrote the definitive treatise in the Lancet on medical cannabis back in the 1880s. Queen Victoria used it for period pain. There you go, here's an interesting one. 1870s, the Father Gillian Gold Medal in the Medical Society for his work on hemp drugs and the treatment of mental illness. Hemp being a form of cannabis that has low THC, high CBD. And the problem then started here, it's an interesting thing. There is a sort of political aspect to this, but I just want to tell you a little bit about the Indian Hemp Commission. So there's always been this feeling, and probably some of you sort of understand this. There are people who smoke a lot of cannabis. They don't function as well as they did. Right? You probably even have friends of yours who, get stoned too often, and you can see it interfering and impairing their academic performance. And ever since the 1890s, there's been this idea that cannabis causes psychiatric illness. So the Indian Hemp Commission was set up. The strong puritanical movement to get rid of all drugs, which actually succeeded in the 1920s in America, get rid of alcohol, was formulated in about 1870, and they started attacking all drugs. The first big attack on cannabis came in the Indian Hemp Commission. And they did a very systematic review. It was a phenomenal review, hundreds of pages. And they came to the conclusion that cannabis isn't causing mental illness in India. But that fear perpetuates, and you know, medical, you know, there are many people who have made their careers out of increasing, re-examining and resurrecting that fear from the dead. But the biggest problem, and the reason cannabis became vilified, was related to the alcohol prohibition. So, 1922, I think, America, Sweden, Norway, they basically ban alcohol. And what does that do? That creates an enormous black market. Alcohol is one's favorite drug, so it's, and the mafia rises, and every policeman in America is corrupt. Every policeman is corrupt because they're getting paid off by the speakeasies, it's the underground drinks bars. So they create a separate army called the Drug Enforcement Agency now, and to fight the mafia. And that was led by this man called Harry Anslinger. And he was the second most famous man in America. Because he got himself on all the news. Every time they did a bust of booze, he was on the news. And then, horror of horrors, the Senate decides that alcohol is going to be legal again. So he faces losing his job, and he's got about 35,000 men working for him. And he doesn't want them to lose their jobs. He doesn't want to lose his preeminent position. So what does he do? He creates a new scare. He creates the fear of cannabis, but to make it more pertinent to Americans, he calls it marijuana, because that's what the Mexicans call it. And then he creates these stories about Mexicans bringing marijuana into America, getting young American men stoned out of their heads, and you can see some of the more lurid, ridiculous. It's interesting, isn't it? There's always, whenever there's hysteria about drugs, the hysteria is always associated with nudity and the possibility of sexual assault. So they kind of, they titillate the middle class, but also allow them the justification for running it. And I mean, this truly, you know, is an absurd statement. Anyone, you know, everyone who's met anyone who's been stoned with drugs is completely unviolent compared with alcohol. But these are absurd statements were made. And in order to fulfill the fear, or to fuel the fears about marijuana, he persuaded the Americans to stop using it as a medicine, because it was a medicine there as well. And then it ceased to be a medicine, and then they persuaded the WHO, the League of Nations then, to stop the problems. So it wasn't a medicine. In fact, Britain, there were two things we stood up to the Americans on, in terms of drug control. The first was we didn't ban cannabis. We kept cannabis as a medicine until 1971, when eventually, after decades of American pressure, we conceded. And we also, at the same time, in 1928, the Americans decided to ban heroin, because they thought if you didn't prescribe heroin, then people wouldn't use it recreationally. It's a kind of absurd idea. We held out against them as well. We still have it. We're the very few countries in the world where you can still prescribe heroin. Because we know that there's almost no diversion from prescribed heroin to street. And the most amazing thing in the States now is the complete proof of what I've just said. You've heard of the American opioid crisis, right? Well, I guess you need to be very careful not to get carried wrong in the hysteria. Everyone thinks we're going to go the same way, but we're not. Same ways of hopping doctors and paying for prescriptions. But the American opioid crisis is amazing, because when they got they found that they were massively over prescribing OxyContin and fentanyl, then the government said, you've got to stop prescribing. So they then stopped prescribing. And hundreds of thousands of people went into withdrawal. And what did they turn to? They turned to heroin. So you have in America, you have the 16,000 heroin deaths here of a drug which isn't prescribed, but just it goes to show that there's no relationship whatsoever to the availabilities of prescription. Anyway, cannabis was banned. They tried to eliminate it from the pharmacopoeias of the world, and it It was the war on drugs, when Nixon really decided that the future was getting re-elected in his 1968 election. He decided the war on drugs was the way to deviate people from the war in Vietnam. And cannabis was, because it's so widely used, was a very easy target. And in 1971, we caved in and we made cannabis illegal. Now, of course, what's happened in the States is that the individual states have autonomy, and they resurrected cannabis, but in Britain, we didn't resurrect it because we don't have any individual states. And consistently, attempts to revoke the ban have been ignored. This is a phenomenal report. It's beautiful, you know, the beautiful report. The Nixon's own government said there's no harms in cannabis, but they were ignored. The House of Lords report, which is a remarkable report, I read it last year, reread it. It's just absolutely on the ball in terms of all the benefits of cannabis and gives a really balanced view of harms and benefits. Recommended that it should be made a medicine, restored as a medicine. But that doesn't happen. Why didn't it happen in Britain? It didn't happen in Britain because David Cameron, when he became head of the Tory party, when they were in opposition, used drugs to attack Labour. And him and the Daily Mail attacked Labour viciously on many drugs, not just cannabis, on mushrooms, metal mushrooms, illegal, to 2004 when Cameron attacked the Labour Party and made them illegal. Basically, the attempt to make cannabis a medicine in 2003 was then switched in order so that Blair and Brown could say they were harder on drugs than the Tories. And so then we have this intervening period of nearly 20 years when actually we've done nothing other than prosecute people for abuse. And of course, in order to keep that, in order to keep that pretense that cannabis is a very dangerous drug, you have to get sort of experts to say it's dangerous. And who are the experts that say it's dangerous? Well, they're largely psychiatrists. And psychiatrists have promulgated this idea that if we didn't have cannabis, we wouldn't have schizophrenia. I mean, it's utterly absurd. There's no relationship whatsoever in the world between cannabis use and schizophrenia. But it was an argument that fed into the political desires at the time, and it's still there. And when doctors are telling you a drug is really dangerous, even if they're just psychiatrists, you know, the lowest form of doctor life, just about, but they're still a doctor, and that's good enough for the public. Anyway, I don't want to go through all this in any much more detail. I just wanted to show you a couple of business and case studies that will be very back in. But these are all online. When you go onto the Drug Science website, you get all these slides, you can click on and get these nice little videos, etc. And then we got to this situation where eventually, through Hannah and Charlotte Caldwell, two children, severe epilepsy, the parents pushed them to the fore of the debate, and they got the law changed. But Dr. Nutt was ready, and it is truly, truly absurd, and that is why we have set up this 2021 initiative so we can get 20,000 people who need medical cannabis in medical cannabis at a price they can afford, and we can then evaluate the benefits of medical cannabis in a way which hopefully will tell us one way or the other whether it works and whether it's positive. I don't want to, these are just other things. I just want to show you this graph here. So there's a sort of belief in politicians and voters and people that banning things, well, the first thing is they ban things because that's what they can do. That's just, because you can make laws, and laws are easy to make. They don't do anything good. But people say, well, it doesn't matter, they might not do any good, but at least we're doing something. And it can't do any harm, can it? Can banning a drug do any harm? Well, in fact, it can, because here you see, this is one of the reasons modern cannabis research is rather limited is because when it was nascent, this period here when there was a great deal of interest, we began to, the cannabis receptors were discovered, people began to make synthetic cannabinoids. It was going to be a really big new branch of medicine. And then look, war on drugs, make it illegal, publications disappear because there's no research. It's not that you can't do the research. It's just that the governments won't fund it because funding research is almost saying that the drug has a value. And they don't want it to have a value. They would like you never to say the word cannabis again. They would like people never to know about cannabis think that way it'll disappear. So you can get funding, and if you can't, and if you, but because it's illegal, also you have this absurd situation. You know that for me, to, for us to work on cannabis, as we have done, we have to have a special license. We have a special license to hold cannabis in my hospital. I can hold heroin because I'm a doctor. But cannabis has a, you know, it costs thousands of pounds, takes months and months to get. It's an absurdity, which is a, which is basically is the explanation as to why there's such a terrible deficit in research. It's coming back now, thankfully, but we've lost, you can see how many years we've lost, you know, we've lost nearly 30 years of sensible research. And the same is true for mushrooms, and the same is true for LSD and other psychedelics. That's just what I wanted to say, really. If you want to ask me questions, I've got another 10 minutes.
I was wondering, I know it's quite far-fetched, but was there ever a correlation between banning cannabis and then an increase in diseases, which are, like, throughout the population, which cannabis targets, in a way, if you see what I mean? Like, was there an increase in incidence of epilepsy? Or, I mean, it's quite hard to control for a study like that, I imagine.
Yeah, no, that's a really interesting question, and the answer is I don't know. I'm just thinking whether there was anything... well, I mean, there was a big increase in criminal use of it, but that's not a thing. Which, and that was particularly true when we banned heroin. Can I just digress a second for a moment? In 1971, the Americans didn't just make us ban cannabis. They also, every single drug law in this country, with the exception of the Psychoactive Substances Act, which is our own crazy, but up to that point, every drug law in our country has been made because the Americans wanted us to. You know, sometimes we've been slow in digging it up, but they always get their way in the end. The most recent one being when we banned cat in about 2016. So the Americans determine our drug rules. We don't admit to that, but it's a fact. Mm-hmm. I know it's a fact because when I chaired the ACMD, I would have meetings with the Foreign Office who say, you've got to ban this drug. And I'd say, no. And they said, you've got to ban it. The Americans want to ban it. I don't want to ban it. That's one of the reasons they got sacked, because they got really irritated that I wouldn't comply with the American desire to get a big ban. So in 1971, the Americans made us stop prescribing heroin. We used to prescribe heroin to heroin addicts, so that, and we had 1,000 heroin addicts in 1971. In 20 years, we went from 1,000 to 200,000. Why? Because every heroin addict has to have 25 other addicts to feed their habit. And you can work out, you know, if you're going to do it multiples of 25, you don't take very long to go from 1,000 to 200,000. So yeah, so there is, so banning drugs actually can massively increase the black market. We can say categorically that there was no increase in of the disorders that cannabis is supposed to have caused. As in 1971, there were 500,000 people in Britain that never used cannabis. 20 years later, it's 10 million. So it's a 20-fold increase in the use of cannabis, in the number of people using, probably 100, probably it's a 50-fold increase in the amount used. And no increase in schizophrenia, no increase in, as far as I can name, was the any of the disorders that cannabis supposedly caused. So the answer is, you know, the evidence that cannabis causes harm is very limited. The big harm it causes is by getting you imprisoned and screwing up your medical career, so don't ever get caught with it. Still, no, we had a medical student in Bristol when I was there. We had to monitor him every year. He's caught with cannabis, and we had to monitor him under the GMC every year for the rest of his life just to make sure he's not a drug addict. Completely insane. That's the nature of illegality. Anything else you want to ask me? Yeah.
So clearly, as we've discussed, some of this issue is that doctors don't feel comfortable prescribing something that they don't know so much about.
Yes.
And so having a session like this is really beneficial for the future doctors.
Thank you for coming, by the way. I'm really grateful you came. This was a bit of an experiment and it's worked.
But also, clearly some of the issue is political and legal in nature.
Yes.
And is there a way that we could also try and sort of not infiltrate, but educate the future lawyers of the world? Like, how can we do that? Because they're in control of a lot of these laws and they're the future as well.
Well, absolutely. When your mates who are doing law, you know, you catch them snorting cocaine, point out to them that, you know, we have had lawyers who have been banned because of the Yeah, I think the mess. Yeah, I think that what the way forward is for people like you to educate your peers and your parents if that's possible. But also, the main driver is it is a medicine now, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's not the fact we have changed the law.
Yeah.
The challenge is getting doctors to prescribe. Now, from my perspective, I'm a psychopharmacologist, psychiatrist. You know, the brain is an organ which works on chemicals, right? You know, I mean, there's 80 different neurotransmitters. So, cannabis has a lot of different chemicals. Marriage made in heaven. You can find the right chemicals to make the right changes in the brain or elsewhere in the body. So, for me, it's a fantastic opportunity. You know, it's a unique opportunity to have so many ways of helping people. And you've got to try to get that message across to doctors. I believe the problem is, and that was why I said what I said about 10 minutes ago, I think in Britain, we have been more hostile to cannabis than almost any other country. Not quite as hostile as Sweden, but most countries in the world, and Russia, but most countries in the world are not anti-cannabis because they know it's beyond this. So, but we have actively vilified, and we've used cannabis as an explanation for disorders like schizophrenia, we've vilified people who use cannabis. That, I think, my generation of doctors have lied so much that they don't want to admit they were wrong. I mean, that's kind of a difficult thing, isn't it? You know, you've been telling people how dangerous it is for 30 years, and then suddenly you see it curing people. So they don't want to have their eyes opened. You've got to open them for them. You've got to say, well, why don't we try this? You know, we're allowed to, why don't we try it? And when you get to a point where you become the decisive writer of prescriptions, then you definitely should try it.
Has there been any discussion with designers of medical, creators of a medical curriculum at individual universities, medical schools, to start discussing this?
Well, so this is why we've got these two slide sets. So they're out there, we're going to be communicating them to, we're going to send them to all medical schools. We're going to try to set up a proper, even more detailed and extensive set of training slides around this initially, and then roll them out to other drugs that are going to have to be evaluated as psychedelics. So this is the first time, you know, you guys all here are the start of a process. We're hoping to roll out these kind of lectures across not just medical schools, but also schools of pharmacy, but as pharmacists are also in need of education. Yeah?
Is someone else behind me?
Yeah.
So, me? So you talk about all the positive effects of cannabis, but if you can, what are the actual negative effects of the cannabis plant?
The negative effects?
Yeah. If you can think of
them. Well, the biggest negative effect is being chronically stoned. And that is generally not good for most people's careers, so try to avoid that. I mean, it might be quite good if you're a musician, but probably not good if you're an accountant. But beyond that, actually, one of the most remarkable, there are two things I should say, historical things. What I only learned recently, I only learned it last week, that the first modern scientific evidence that cannabis treated epilepsy was in 1949. I mean, O'Shaughnessy said it did. He said it's sort of about ticks and things back in the 1860s, but the first sort of scientific study was 1949. And then the American government has systematically buried any positive data. The head of the National Institute of Health in America, the respiratory laboratory, came to the conclusion in the mid-60s that smoking cannabis was protective against lung cancer. Exactly the opposite of tobacco, suppressed. There are many trials of using cannabis oil to treat skin cancer suppressed. Because it's illegal, it was illegal, the American government has systematically tried to deny evidence of truth. So yeah, to answer your question, what are the harms? Yeah, I mean, people,
COPD?
Well, not really, because what we're using as a medicine, we're not encouraging people to smoke spliffs. You want to take an oil, or you can vaporize. They've got these really nice little vaporizers now that speeds up the flower.
And this is
medicine.
Yeah, I was just wondering, I remember a couple of years ago when we were learning about cannabis and pharmacology, that we didn't really understand the way it works on the cannabinoid receptors.
Yeah.
And I was wondering if maybe the reason from a pharmacological perspective that doctors are averse to it because they don't really understand? Do we have a better understanding of
that's the other slide set, which I haven't got time to go through. But yes, we do.
Yeah.
The second slide set is a beautiful slide set which covers all the endocannabinoids.
Yeah.
And there are drugs being made, and this is going to be one of the paradoxes, there are drugs being made to facilitate endocannabinoids by preventing their breakdown.
Yeah.
And they may become, let's just spread broaden your insights a bit. There's a huge tension here between traditional pharmaceuticals and cannabis medicines. Because one of the reasons, the pharmaceutical companies are not doing medical cannabis. Why not? Because you can't patent it. Now, the fact that, and that's why we're doing it. Because if we didn't do it, no one would do it. You can't patent it, it doesn't fit into the conventional model. But then if you invent a drug which blocks the enzyme that breaks down endocannabinoids, like a nitrate-based inhibitor, then you can sell that as a medicine.
Mm-hmm.
And that's great, it's an interesting piece of science, but we may not need that. But one of the sad things is that doctors have become completely entrained to think that only large-scale, multi-center, meta-analytical kind of trials are meaningful. And of course that's absurd. Medicines, that most of what you do in medicine is using common sense, using drugs which are in people where they're not properly in trial, because clinical trials are all about selecting patients who don't have comorbidities. So clinical trials are actually relatively poor predictors of the value of what we're doing. But we've become enslaved by the people that, like Nice, who say they're the only evidence that is meaningful. They're not. They're Nice are approaching this simply from a kind of economic perspective. They're not approaching it from the perspective of a therapist.
I was going to ask about the mechanism by which cannabis works, because obviously there's evidence that suggests it works for MS, chronic pain, epilepsy. Is it one mechanism for all, or how much do we know about?
We know extremely little about it, and that's slide rather tells you why, isn't it? We're 30 years of no research. and also, don't get me started. But we don't even know if the antagonist block it. We banned the cannabis antagonist a few years ago because there was a hysterical concern about them giving people negative thoughts and depressive ideas. So we can strip out half the toolkit because we don't, we just cannot bear the word cannabis being attached to the brain. So we don't know how it works, and it's to do that you'd have to essentially study things like a little bit of work on, so you can use cannabinoids to treat schizophrenia. There's a little bit of work showing that they change the level of endocannabinoids in the CRF, but there's very little systematic work. So what the current thinking, so if your bosses say to you, well, why would you use cannabis? You say it's a kind of homeostatic process. The idea is that the endocannabinoids have a kind of powerful resetting or stabilizing effect in the brain, and this the term that's being used, I don't fully like it, because they're called adaptogens, and they seem to bring things back to the set point, the normal point. So they seem to work whether you've got an excess or a deficit of endocannabinoids. So adaptogen is the term that's been used, and until we get a better one, that's it's conceptually reasonable. If you have you all understand homeostasis and the hormones, so maybe there's some kind of homeostasis around the way synapses. All right, well, I'm going to have to go off and do another talk now, so thank you very much. Thanks for coming. Really, do appreciate you coming. So if those of you who have enjoyed it, will you become followers of Drug Science? It's free. Go on the Drug Science website, look at the slides, and just keep sharing your